happening to these turtles? They're transforming.
Swallowed too much seawater by the looks of it.
Foolish to attempt an escape by sea in these waters. Lucky find.
perjure myself, you pointy.
A group of magisters circle an elf, weapons drawn. The hound barks to draw their attention.
Sir, we've got company.
Ah, planning an ambush with this scion, were you? The witch don't fool me. She's wrecked this ship by herself. With a collar on.
I tell you, I am no witch. The spores do this. If I do not find the rest.
Store the elven hedge magic. Weren't much use when we flooded your forest with death fog, were it? Lucian said it was a necessary evil. Me? I was just sorry we didn't get the lot of you.
You? I try to give you a chance. More than your divine order give mine.
Oh, sir. Her armor!
The scion twitches in sudden rage, and her armor uncoils as if made of living vines.
No more chances.
Ah! Thank you.
A snarl of vines snakes upward from the corpse. After a moment, the vines have split the corpse's chest with incredible force. Thin roots wriggle from limbs and nail beds, anchoring it to the ground. The vines encircle a rough depression, as if something held there was violently torn free. The elf murmurs, stroking her armor as if soothing a wild beast. It is incomplete, and made, it seems, from the vines themselves.
The spores grieve. They wish only to create, not kill. This is why they grow armor from the vines, do you see? To protect me.
It is the magisters who destroy, who separate the spores, anger them. A sad thing, even so. The spores are creation magic. So old, even we scions forget.
I find them. Hope they can restore the ancestor trees lost in the war.
But the magisters chain me and send my spores away. For study. And in wrong hands.
She gestures at the entangled corpses, vines still spattering gore onto the deck.
The ship docks at the mainland before this island. Where exactly, I do not know. But I think the armor does. The presence within wakes. It wants to be whole. Perhaps then it truly speaks as the ancestor trees do. I find its spore mates and see.
You help enough. My armor guides me now, and it is eager to be gone. I hope one day you visit my homeland. Where the ancestor trees bloom once more.
Spotted something.
Thank you.
A serene elf potters between his plants. Noticing your interest, he beckons you over with a smile. Stranger, come. I know this hellish place seems devoid of welcome, but look, Tyr Sendilia smiles. My seedlings grow strong. May their life bring joy to our own. Isn't nature just marvelous? It's good to meet a fellow green thumb. Here, a gift from one gardener to another. Beaming widely, he hands you a bucket and a seedling before patting your hands affectionately. Oh, anywhere you like. Just plant the seedling in the bucket, then place it in the ground. Herbs have their own wisdom. They can take it from there. The elf beams a wider grin than you've seen so far in Fort Joy. Many plants can be coaxed to life in this way. The more the merrier for them and for us. The jolly expression on his face falters and drops. Hollow-eyed, he twists and turns the plant in his hands until it is no more than dead leaves and dirt. Death fog. All gone. All gone. All gone. By Mindula. No more. No more my Samil. My Valeria. His mouth sets in a stern line, cruel and stubborn. After that, I took life. I took all the life that was taken from me. And then some. And more. And more. And more. Your words seem to jolt him back to the present moment. He shakes his head, and the mask of hatred disappears. He smiles again, even wider than before, yet his eyes stay hollow. Oh, look at me, reminiscing about the olden days again. Far better to work the soil, to tend the seedlings, to make life, to make life, to make life. The elf returns to his planting, grinning and humming a happy little ditty under his...
Thank you. Hear me, human. Leave.
The child doesn't lift her head. Thank you.
Always want to talk. Can't I just play here with my shells a while?
Bishop's much taller than I'd imagined from the paintings, and the hammer is so much younger.
Our hope, our salvation, hear our prayer. Rise from among us, O chosen one, and deliver us.
Thank you.
The woman looks up as you approach, wiping her brow with a grease-blackened...
What do you need? By all means, get an eyeful.
The woman looks up as you approach.
What do you need? By all means, get an eyeful.
Bolted on there tight, ain't it?
The woman looks up as you...
What do you need? By all means, get an eyeful. The hammer got you curious. Yeah, funny name for a gal like that. When I knew her, the feather would have been a likelier name. Oh, I don't know. She was a sweet soul, quiet, loved her family. Always seemed strong, as I recall, but she didn't come across as no fearless military leader back then. She was just a girl. People do change, don't they?
She nods once.
Clever lass, her. No wonder what Alexander sees in her. Question is, what she sees in him.
Left of thy new meat bag. Bow before Scepter the Ineffable. Bow before it's too late. Ha! Of course, precious. But which is worse, the cure of a disease?
Don't regret keeping those friends of yours at your right. I brought my own share.
Cowrie, cockle, clam.
Do you find a use for that rope, my friend? I am sure it helps ease your burdens.
He taps hammer to nail and doesn't look up.
Amid the squalor of Fort Joy, you suddenly spot an elf with diamond features, regal and radiant, but cold too, and sharper than any knife. She was the one who sat rolling dice in the ship that went under, deciding fates with every roll, or so she said. Her eyes are focused on a lizard some distance away,
and you get the distinct feeling he's an unfortunate man indeed to be trapped in her tiger-like gaze. No sooner have these words left your mouth than she turns about and grabs you in a stranglehold. You feel the tip of a long needle being pushed a little ways into your neck.
You caught me off guard. No one catches me off guard. Better tell me who you really are, or this time, I'll let my needle do the licking. But you did, and now the tables have turned. You look quite startled to me.
A push, a pivot, and now you suddenly face her. The needle still all too deeply embedded in the side of your throat. Despite the precariousness of your situation, you notice something that remained undetected in the gloom of the ship. A flaw in her diamond features. A curiously shaped scar on her left cheek.
Let me tell you a little story. Once upon a bad old time, a lizard cut this thing, this living scar, into my cheek. The mark of a slave. But now I'm free, of sorts. And I've traced that lizard here to Fort Joy. I intend to raise the subject with him.
She drives the needle in deeper and whispers.
In truth, it does not matter in the least who you really are. You saw me mark my prey. You could warn him, save him, or kill him before I get my chance. That makes you a liability. That makes you needle feed.
A bright sparkle of laughter follows your proposal.
Ha! How amusing. I admit I had not seen that twist coming. I was certain the pitiful begging was about to begin. Make your case and do it quickly. Why should I join you? Escape. How you do tickle me. Most of the misguided dears around here would argue such a thing is impossible. Well played. Oh, little needle mine, what should I do? Push or pull? You know what? Today is a rather fine day. Sunshine and an easy breeze. Yes, I'll let you live. I'll even agree to travel with you, provided we talk to that lizard I mentioned. I'm not quite sure the weather will save him.
With a casual flick of the wrist, she withdraws the needle from your neck and smiles, as if she just invited you to sit down for tea.
Let's discuss our respective roles then, shall we? You, me and Death will be playing many a round of hide and seek. So, what role would you like me to play? As a rogue, my speciality is stealth, the quick silence of the dagger striking unseen. That said, I'm perfectly lethal, wielding any weapon or magic. So, the choice is yours. My grace and finesse could make a cat's fur go green with envy. Go on, give me the details. Suits me fine. Lead on. Or better yet, let me take the lead. Then follow me.
You're not quite certain you'll ever sleep soundly with Sibyl in any sort of proximity, but at least she's on your side for the moment.
Thank you.
Just as you're about to address the lizard, the Red Prince bars you with an outstretched arm.
This man is a dreamer. As you know, I need a word with him. You may wait here while I speak. Permission indeed.
He bids the dreamer stand up and pay attention, which he does in a groveling and awkward manner. The dreamer then chews and swallows a handful of Drudenay leaves before slipping into a trance-like state. He falls asleep. To your surprise, the Red Prince lies down and follows suit. After about half an hour, they wake up and begin to discuss what they saw in their dreams. The Red Prince pinches the bridge of his nose in apparent irritation before turning his back on the jabbering dreamer. You receive a withering glance in response.
A deserved bit of sarcasm, I suppose. But though this stingtail fellow may be a less than stellar specimen in the firmament of dreamers, the dreams themselves prove to be quite elucidating. Turns out I'm being hunted by an enemy I didn't know actually existed. The myth-shrouded House of Shadows. The dreamers, though, they're on my side. And they've visions of me on the throne. That's because you haven't seen that other world in all its glory. It is majestic. Fit for a prince. Oh, I was born with the promise of an empire. And that promise will be kept. But to keep it, I must find a second dreamer. A greater one. A more experienced traveler of the dream world. Bahara is her name. And she resides in the swamplands east of the fort. So, let us make our escape and venture there post-haste.
You know, I could tell you all about swamp dreamers, too, if I chewed that much Drudene.
Huh? What? But I was... It was... Please, tell me. Tell me... Why did you wake me? I was so close. So close! And you smell of burnt hair and barren dreams. But I have the good breeding not to mention it. They don't call us dreamers for nothing, I'm afraid. My purpose is to dream, and for that I need to sleep. Now, if you'll excuse me. Oranges. Is that what he told you he's missing? Well, I suppose it's technically true. Though I'd guess Mr. Griff is more upset about the Drudene than the citrus. The Drudene Griff cleverly smuggles into the prison, of course, stuffed inside the oranges. You don't think he'd really be so mad over a little missing fruit, do you? No, it's not the oranges, but the dreams he's after. Same as I, though. I have the right, the responsibility. Drudene, it makes you master of all you see when you sleep. The dreamer is not the play actor, but the playwright. It may be hard for you to understand, but my kind, we dream for the greater good. What we see can predict the truth, can even shape the truth. But we need Drudene to do it. Before I was caught, before I was brought here, I saw a vision. The void woken, slain, divinity restored. But just as I was about to see how it happened, the Magisters beat down my door. This is my last chance to find out the secret, to find out how to save us all. So you see, I cannot give back the Drudenay, not only for myself, but for all of us. My dreams are my gift. They may be our salvation, too. To save a life. Ah, that elven fellow in the cage, I suppose. I knew he'd been suspected, but it all seemed worth it if I could only dream again. Never mind. Take the oranges. The Drudenay, that is. I'll find another way. Somehow.
Caked in mud and blood, looks up at you from the bottom of the cage. He holds his shoulder at a strange angle. Despite his condition, he appears eager for your attention.
You believe what he says? That I am a thief?
Never trust the man who holds the key to another's freedom. Would you trust the fellows who strap that collar around your neck? Like me, you look for your own freedom. Out of Fort Joy. Am I correct? Some people settle in. They don't go poking around in Griff's kitchen. They find a quiet place, wait their turn. Not you. Smart. In this case, I think we help each other. Griff tells you, does he not? I take his supplies, but I don't take what he thinks. I do not have his oranges. I tell you what I know. But first, I want to make a trade. I know a way out. I show you. And you help me out of here. I cannot die in this cage. Finally. Progress. Griff releases me if he sees I do not have what he misses. You must find who steals them. After I am free, you are free. Griff is a powerful man. Power is mysterious, in case you haven't noticed. I intend no harm. I want only some provisions. A bit of bread, a potato or two. Nothing Griff should be loath to give. I need to escape, and I have people to consider. You understand? I see no one. In fact, I only hear the sound of Griff clearing his throat. You know how he does. Like so. For some time, I think Griff takes his own supplies. But I see the anger in him that he does not find it. He truly does not find what he seeks. Thank you. And...
Griff glances from his blade to you and back again.
You already know the terms. Nothing else to say.
Got it.
He turns the card over and holds it up to the light, smirking.
Got your hands on my sparkler, did ya? Well, put it to good use. The louses I have at the card table could use a good shake-up. Spare the indignation and hand it over. Now. Good boy. Looks like everything's accounted for. Now the important question. Who's the thief?
This Griff is nothing but a thug. Don't give up Stingtails so easily.
I don't want Stingtails' blood on my hands.
Griff would kill a fellow over petty theft. Giving up Stingtail is no better than murder.
This Griff is nothing but a thug. Don't give up Stingtail so easily.
This Griff is nothing but a thug. Don't give up Stingtail so easily.
I'm right chuffed to have my supplies back, so I'm gonna give you one last chance. Tell me who you found them on, or you're gonna have to answer to me, my knife, and each one of my people. And your little elf friend won't make it out alive neither. Oh, you must think I'm playing with you. I don't play, and I'm over.
like this. I won't let them.
Reveal yourself.
Prepare yourself.
You're not trying to escape, are you?
Rubbish. Again. Junk.
Thank you. Thank you.
You eat Griff's hand, and you see him putting animals, dead for days in the blistering sun, whole into his cooking pot. Probably best to pass on a stew.
When another divine arises, will source change back? What if there are no sources?